It is 6:36. A quorum being present, we'll call the regular meeting of the Rochester-Stockbridge Unified District Board of School Directors to order. Adjustments to the agenda. I have two. We need to add a very brief action item around getting our buildings air tested and fuel tanks tested, and approving some initial investigation of that. So we can have the administration go forward on that. And then we also have to add, we're going to add at the beginning, a executive session to discuss a student matter.
Building environmental testing.
I'd like to clarify, it was probably a miscommunication on my part too. Christine, downwards discussion items, I was trying to inform her that at our December meeting, the agenda item would be budget discussions, so.
We don't actually have any budget discussions.
That was supposed to just be for next month.
10.1 should read, December meeting agendas, : budget discussion.
Colon.
And we'll delete 10.2 completely.
Yeah, no, I don't think there's no need to discuss, is there, at all? I think that it was actually just supposed to go down to 16, maybe, future.
Okay,
future,
sure.
Agenda items.
You can put it in 16 if you like. That works for me. As long as we're not supposed to be talking about the budget tonight, I don't care if your hands up on the agenda.
Bonnie, do you
No, we're fine.
Bonnie, do you have a schedule that you were going to hand us?
Bonnie, Wendy, do you guys have any?
Report.
Yeah.
I didn't make copies of it.
Yeah. Because you were going to.
I can email it to you.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's
because you said you were going to hand them out to us.
Do either of the two of you have anything you wanted to change about the agenda?
I need to just update the board about a roofing situation at the elementary school, but I can do that in the principal's report.
That'd be great.
Okay.
And can we just change 7.1 to say literacy framework? Because that's what the overview we're going to talk about today, not the F&P.
Literacy framework.
This is 7.2, you said, or
7.1?
7.1.
Okay, framework.
We'll clarify that it can be a literacy framework. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I have, on old business, the marquee update, the installation.
The marquee update, if you recall, we were going to talk and convene about budgeted buildings items on December. This meeting is focused on education and literacy and student outcomes.
Well, I'm just asking for an old business update.
Okay, sure. I can give you, I will give you the update right now. It's that we'll have information for you at the December meeting. Thanks, Mason.
I shouldn't laugh.
Anyone else? Bruce?
No, I think I put policies on. I'm giving you the ones that we've gone through the policy committee so far. Yep. There will be more to follow.
Do you need
you to look at them?
Do you need action on them?
I'd love to have action, but that's up to you.
But we haven't looked at them yet.
We're going to have some information on transparency that came from the Secretary of State's office and various.
Okay, well let's handle those in the superintendent's report. I think would be a good place to.
Okay.
Yep. And okay, we're not there.
I'm not going to comment on
that. So
we have questions. We can ask you them about them then. So, public comment.
Have we assigned a timekeeper?
We have not.
Okay, that is the next thing.
That's true.
Number three.
And I'm sorry.
I'm so used to kind of not having you.
Yeah.
Where did we add the executive session? Was that under?
Are we moving?
There is one.
We're adding one at the top.
Oh,
so
under
top
where?
Where?
I'm sorry, right after public comment.
So
okay, so
4.5.
Five.
Is exact.
Okay, thank you. And that's the student?
I'm happy to
be the student matter.
I'm happy to be timekeeper if that's.
Oh, I'd love you to be timekeeper.
What's the rules? Do we have times on things?
We have times on the items in number 7, and that is it.
Oh, I see.
I think that given that we have two executive sessions already, and we have over an hour of discussions on literacy and student assessment. I would say let's try to keep public comment to 10 minutes, 15 minutes, something like that.
Okay. Executive session, do we have a time limit on that or not?
We do not.
Okay. Do we need one?
We do not, because we need as long as we need.
So we'll do the present literacy reports of superintendent and principal. Principals, I've read it. Anybody else?
I've read it.
I've looked at it. Let's slot them in for 5 or 10 minutes in case
five
comments.
I'll say five.
Well, remember, Bonnie asked for extra time to talk about the roofing matter.
Okay, so I'll give her there. I'll give her five plus on principal's report.
Shouldn't take more than seven.
Did you?
Seven.
How about the principal's report was not included in the packet.
I'll be start making annoying thing.
We're not getting as granular as second. Seven.
Policy review. How long do you need?
Just 5 minutes.
5 minutes. Thank you. I'm good at this stuff.
The right person for the job.
Four.
Summer. If you do say so yourself.
If I do. I'm going to say 5 minutes for agenda items.
Sure.
And then action items. Can we do that? What are we taking on that? 10 minutes.
I would say it's going to take at least 10 minutes to finalize a retreat date. I think that a corporate resolution data treasurer, assuming that
I've got all
the
that.
Has sent us the form and the stuff we need, that's a matter of just entertaining a motion.
What's great is that all these are after.
Yeah.
And then the second executive session again will take as long as it needs to take.
Okay.
Good.
All right.
He's
Thank
ready.
You. That's all. I'm good.
Okay. Gentlemen.
Public comment.
Start your iPhone. Yes.
I've got a couple of questions. First off, are we willing to get a second hand generator for the school? Are we open to that option? Because there's one locally that it hasn't been used. It was serviced 2 years ago. My husband's going to do it. So the metered hours that it was actually used, it was barely used, and it's large enough probably to power more than this building.
That's good to know. If you could reach out and send that information to Lindy, so that because the only thing that pops in the top of my head would be that some of the grant funding we're going to try to get to put that in here because it's the emergency shelter. I don't know if that would count for you. That's just one of those.
Forgive
silly
me.
Governments.
Can I just ask your name? I'm not.
Caitlin
McKinstry. Okay. Hi. And are you working with the generator thing, or is this just?
I am not. I stumbled upon this locally,
great.
And I just figured.
Thank you so much for coming in.
And they're very big on local communities, so we may be able to get it donated.
Oh.
I just wanted to make sure this was something that you guys would be interested in.
That's great.
Donated
thank
might
you.
Make us not worry so much about losing $5,000 or $8,000 from efficiency of the mall.
Well, it's like a $25,000 generator.
Yeah. So yeah, reach out to Lizzie and thank Mark for passing that along too.
Yeah, thank you so much. So the oil tanks that are in the ground, have we looked at the cost of switching the burners over to propane, just getting the tanks set above ground and then looking at the cost? Because what happens when old oil tanks out, you get into biohazard, you get into the EPA, and it's very expensive to remove them. Have we looked at that cost, switching that over, it's a little more efficient, and then maybe getting a quote and looking forward to saving up for those tanks to be moved?
Yeah, there's the couple things we found about that, and we'll be talking again more about building issues at the December meeting. Is there's a grant program in Vermont that helps helps fund taking those things out. It kind of works like an insurance program. I think you would pay, if I recall correctly from the building committee, it's like $10,000 a tank is the maximum the district would pay for each of the tanks in Rochester because they're over 1,500 gallons. The tank in Stockbridge is only like 1,000 gallons with. Our maximum exposure would be 250. But one of the things I wanted to do with my action item was to authorize the principals to go out, get that information, and get us some proposals so that we know what we're looking at when we start into budgeting next year. Because if we haven't done our legwork, we're not going to be able to.
Right. So switching over to propane is much simpler, and then you guys can figure out the oil situation later because all you have to do is change the burners, and the companies retain ownership of the propane.
And they're above ground. They can just sit on a cement.
So they can do either. They can go into doing buried propane tanks. It's going to be more expensive, but yes, they can just set them on and typically the company coming and do flatten out the area and setting the tanks and hooking them up and changing out the burners.
Wow, great information. Thank you.
Yeah.
Great.
And if you know, if this is a thing that interests you, I will point out that next Tuesday you're not doing anything. 6:30 building committee meeting.
Six o'clock.
Six o'clock.
Where
sorry.
Is it here?
This one's in Rochester. In the elementary school library.
Tuesday.
It's one of the squatty chair meetings as opposed to grown size seats here.
Security for Stockbridge, do you have anything worse for that? We don't even have security glass here. So do you have any ideas of when that may happen?
Security glass?
What did I see about that?
You know, so there's
safety glass?
Not safety glass, but there's wire mesh within it. So you can't break through it. Most public buildings have that now on the exterior doors. And how we also look at I know in my elementary school they just had flat flush doors on the outside with enough handles for the classrooms to go in and out of classrooms for exit, but nobody could get in.
I do know that is on the team research. I did a walkthrough with the state trooper that designed our building to just talk about different things like that, and we are going to a safety conference in
I just have one more comment and then I'm done. So I read through the building thing and I know we're unpacking it and going to look through it and stuff. I feel for the board it may be valuable for you guys to look at what avenue you're taking, what avenues you're not going to be doing, and making the community aware of that. Otherwise, some of this information we're going to look at and panic and think this and that.
It's already happened.
It would be good to kind of really decide what you're definitely not going to do so you can address that and then others aren't going to keep worrying about it.
Right. I can tell you.
That's a good idea.
I don't want to spoiler alert the building committee meeting next week, but I can tell you in a really quick recap, one of the things that we're working on doing is taking all that information that the engineering firm gave us and breaking it into broad categories of, okay, if this is true, what would happen? What would it look like if we just closed all the schools? What would it look like if we had just one school in every one of the different places? If everyone, what would it take to make this into the one school? What would it take to make either of those buildings into the one school? What would it take to still operate two campuses if we closed building A or closed building B? What would it take to just build a whole new skill? You know, one of the things when you look through that report, it talks a lot about all the things that are wrong. What might it look like to just close all three buildings and build a new building purpose-built between the two towns for the kids? So we're really looking at all the big, broad categories right now to do exactly that, to figure out what we can say we're not going to do. But to do that, we have to kind of figure out all the different buckets.
What you're saying right there is that you're open to closing our school, which is very concerning as a community member.
No, I understand. I'm sorry. I'm not saying that I'm open to anything. I'm saying that part of the job of the committee is to just do the analysis. We've done the analysis in Stockbridge for years, where we've always been able to show that running this school is more cost effective to our taxpayers, just in dollars. Not even looking at.
We're not even using
the
high school, and it's costing us $30,000 a year already, and we're not using it. So you want to talk about a building that's costing too much money. For example, the building we're not using, the community has been using, our schools haven't been.
Right, absolutely. I mean, that's getting that all resolved and getting that all sugared out into the way the communities want is the goal of the committee. What I'm saying is right now, all we're doing in that committee is not, we're not making a recommendation.
we're taking the report and chunking it and saying, what does this report mean? Because if you look at it, there's stuff where it talks about, oh, well, if you were in the elementary school, you need to do, you need to build this. One of the things it doesn't talk
just,
about.
Just so you know, we have 2 minutes left to public comment.
Right, I'll wrap up and give her the last minute. But like, one of the things it doesn't talk about, for example, is repurposing the gym into an art space instead of building another addition on that building. So going through that report, we're trying to unpack it and figure out things that we need to look at further, and also to look at that information and say, you know, let's eliminate this choice or that choice. The decision to close the school would not be based on a dollars and cents report. It would be that I can guarantee you that would only be based on a community decision, and that would be informing the people, because there are people that do express the opposite opinion, so we have to give them, you know, their analysis to say, here's what it is. See, you're not right. So, but I can tell you the intention of the board is not to close anything. We just have to be fair to the analysis. You have to consider all the different angles. You know, it's not just about dollars. Losing the community control over
one
your kids and their education is more important to me than that.
Does anybody have some comments for you for the last minute? No. Okay.
Oh, you have a comment?
Can there be additional time? Can we add more time?
Well, I really want to make sure we get to all the matters that are on the agenda, so a public comment, especially when we have a venue a week away to discuss the building, I think I'd like to wrap up on that side.
I just have something I'd like to submit
to the board. Oh, you have an addition to your own public comment.
Yes.
About something else.
Not comment on that comment.
I see you're going back into building. So go ahead and finish your minute.
So
we don't have a minute left anymore.
No. Okay. Yeah. I'm sorry.
I'll skip that.
If you'd like to submit something without comment, I would certainly take that.
These are letters for, I realize you're a joint board for the Rochester and Stockbridge board relative to a check that you should have received from the Sharon Academy for two sums of money that were a result of overpayments by the supervisory union. So this explains the fact that we came up with that as part of an internal audit, and that those monies are calculated from our audit as overpayments. And we recognize the SU is conducting its own audit right now, and at the time that they can confirm those numbers, we'll sit down with you and adjust that. But that's just a letter of explanation for all of you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Great.
That's great. Thank you very much.
All right.
What a nice thing to do.
I think.
Do you have, what's yours? Well.
So I'm here.
Sounds quite good.
I'm
in
the studio, and I'm here with my wife, Amy Ryan, and we're here to get reassurance that the tuition for our daughter is going to be.
Hold that thought. We'll come right back to you.
Yeah, we're that's the executive session.
Except we really can't be saying.
Oh, we can't. We can't be saying. Oh, we can't say it because that's.
We'll come back to you. Just give us a minute.
Yeah.
I would entertain a motion that we go into executive session to discuss a student matter.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying
aye. Aye.
Aye.
We're going into executive session.
We're going executive.
7:54. We will be right back.
Why did we go in?
Could have taken so much less time.
I don't know, what time did we go in?
No, I was just asking. You need to know what we
did. I don't want to hear about literacy. I really do. We just get.
That's probably skeptical.
What are we waiting for?
Nothing. Bruce, go ahead.
Carl?
Not Bruce.
Jenny?
I'm getting out of state.
Yeah.
Hey, Harry. Harry, go ahead.
I move that the tuition request be approved for the student based upon her individual needs for retention. I don't know if we need to give any more details since there's other people here.
Nope.
Thank you.
Second.
The motion's been made and seconded that the board approve the tuition request for the student based upon her individual needs for retention. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The tuition is paid unanimously. You're welcome. All right.
Thank you.
We have a consent agenda. There are minutes in the notes. I would entertain a motion to approve the minutes of Tuesday, October 1st as presented.
Second.
A motion has been made and seconded that we approve the notes as presented. Discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Minutes have been approved. We have a literacy presentation that we should get into. I am not...
Take the floor, someone.
Yeah, who's doing this? Go for it.
Take the floor.
You got it.
So we thought we would bring you some highlights of things that are going on. We asked Mary Ellen to put something together to be able to give you some idea about what's happening throughout the SU. So,
Go for it.
No, actually, Mary Ellen was going to start, and then Lindy, myself, and Janie are going to speak a little bit to our pilot, and then that was going to be it. So I think we probably don't need the full hour.
Is it possible that you could sit halfway or something just so the camera can pick up some of this? Yeah. Even though the chair, we could give her the...
Why don't we actually, she's soft-spoken. Why don't the three of us move down and she can sit next to Jane?
Yep, great idea.
Oh,
goody.
Or you can leave her there.
Jane, you stay on script.
Goody. Yeah. Sit right here, sweetheart.
Oh, it's being recorded.
I don't believe this.
Okay, go, Mary Ellen.
All right. So across the supervisor union, we've talked about this before at past meetings. We have a focus to improve student learning and reading. That's our big focus for this year. So some of the components of that is professional development that's embedded into that literacy framework, which includes coaching, which we've heard Janie talk about. And in fact, we had the system that she explained. That's what we had in place for professional development for all teachers to improve how they teach reading for students. We know that this is important. We know that if a student can read by third grade, they're more likely to be successful from then on. We also know that if a student is proficient by third grade, they're more likely to do better in math as well as other subjects. This focus that we have on the literacy is part of our strategic plan. So we have a 5-year strategic plan. This is it 2.2.1, or is it something like that?
That's exactly
that
right.
All students will be literate and numerate by grade 3. So that's our focus. So that's a little bit of the background behind this. We have, through this coaching, by having professional development for all the teachers, we have expanded the teacher expertise, not just in reading, but also in classroom management, in other areas. We have common language and collective expertise. Our teachers are working together, which we know is huge for making changes in schools. If we want to change the learning that's happening, we know we have to focus on the instruction that's happening. And by working collectively, we know that's how we do it. And it's based on all the research, and you've probably heard Bruce talk about John Hattie's work and the collective efficacy that happens in that.
Sorry, could you repeat that last thing? I didn't hear.
Okay. There is a researcher, John Hattie,
who's really good.
And he says the number one... Oh, we agree on a lot of things. You'd be surprised. The number one way to change student learning is through collective efficacy.
Meaning all the teachers
working
in a school
together.
Working together.
Collaboration.
Yes.
Yeah.
Collaboration.
Good. Thank you. Keep going.
And that's one of the things that we have put into place. Mm-hmm. We have all of our elementary teachers are participating in professional development through the supervisory union, and over 40 teachers have taken those classes for graduate credit. So that's what we have in place. Any questions?
40 being across the
whole
supervisory
union.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do we know specifics of how many teachers in our two schools, our two campuses have done that?
I don't know. I know we do have some, but I don't know the numbers.
I know that all in Stockbridge, so all those that are eligible for the graduate credit, meaning part of it, for some of the credit, you actually have to be teaching guided reading groups at the
right,
time.
That's right.
So we do have, you know, two teachers, like preschool, they don't do a guided reading group.
Right.
So some of that is, they do literacy, but it's not the same format as kindergarten through sixth grade. And we also have a teacher who mostly just does math and science. So while she does all the trainings and participates in all of them, she can't take the class for graduate credit because some of it is examining student data and really honing in on that, but participating in all the trainings and the readings all their lives.
Yeah.
And I believe there's one person at Rochester taking it for graduate credit, but the other teachers are solely on board with the work.
Mm-hmm. With the work, okay.
They didn't go to the professional development.
They all went to the professional development.
They all went to
all of our teachers.
Everybody did.
Graduate credit is
extra.
Okay.
That's above the
other. And are you going to get to Amy Toth?
Well, that Amy Toth is the person who does the coaching.
Okay.
Where she works side by side with teachers.
Yes. Is that coming up or is that part of what you're talking
about?
That
was that's what I was saying before about when I was saying that we have professional development embedded into this.
And have all our teachers had a session with Amy Toth so far this year?
Yes.
More than one. Coming up on the third.
That's exactly the kind of thing we want to hear.
Yeah.
Just to clarify one thing, the graduate credit is not, it's the professional development work in the schools and the classrooms, but there are a couple of expectations beyond that. Like paper,
right. Everyone is
and theory work behind.
In the coaching and everyone is.
Yes.
And the professional.
So you can't opt out?
No.
Yeah.
Great.
Tomorrow, for example, is a half in-service day, and teachers from Rochester and Stockbridge are getting together here using one of Amy Toth's protocols. They videotaped a mini lesson, and they're going to critique each other. A guided reading lesson. And they're going to critique each other in the components of that guided reading lesson. And that'll be here tomorrow afternoon at Stockbridge for both staff from both campuses.
Very good.
So that's, and what some of the faculty are saying is that we now have a shared vision across the supervisory union. We have common language from grade to grade, from teacher to teacher.
Can you give me an example of the common language of something that all the teachers would be using in all their classes?
Well, I can't give you like a specific example. What I can tell you is that there were some schools that had three different reading programs in the school. So as a student went from grade to grade, the language changed in what they were focusing on in the classroom. And sometimes that can be confusing if you have a struggling reader. The more consistency and the more focus and the central, part of the professional development, it helps.
Mm-hmm.
So
the fact that we're all using the same materials, and we're talking about, each person's got the same materials, they're talking about the same materials, they're sharing ideas about the same materials, all that is just such a great way of promoting that efficacy that we were talking about.
So I heard a little bit about, chatting with one teacher, I heard a little bit about this, that it's these sort of short books, that they're using in this? Is this part of the program?
Depending on the grade level.
Okay, depending on the grade level. And that there's a lot of documenting and stuff like that, that I heard the joke was that she had homework again. She hadn't been working years, and suddenly she's going back, and her husband's like, "Why are you working so hard?" I mean, she's excited about it, the teacher. I guess that's one of the things I'd like to see is I'd even love to see an example of what kind of book are they seeing in first grade? What kind of book are they seeing in third grade? What kind of book are they seeing in sixth grade?
Yeah.
You know, just that kind of detail for us to know where our money's going, and so that then we can have intelligent conversations about this. So that kind of specifics would be very useful for me anyway.
But you're saying that across schools, like all of our kindergarten classes are using the same
books. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
That the teachers can talk to each other about
what
they're And if they share a video across schools, now they can have a conversation about, this is what happened in my classroom, this is what happened in my classroom.
Okay.
And that moves the learning up. Mm-hmm. It's not a cookie cutter approach. It's not you open the book and you turn the next thing.
Yep.
Teachers are building capacity to be able to make decisions as to what's best for the kids and their needs in front of them.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And that's where that homework comes in. Because you have to be able to understand where the kids are in order to move them to the next level.
Do you see this homework?
Yeah, absolutely. I would say the key is that teachers are looking at data every single day on the readers and adjusting the instruction. Because what comes is like this folder, and it's got the books in it, and it's got all these possible things that they can be doing in a reading. Based on the data of that reading group and each individual, Amy is working with classroom teachers that they're supposed to adjust their instruction in that reading group to meet the needs of the strengths and weaknesses of those kids in that reading group.
So if you got 20 kids in your class, that's a lot of note taking.
Yeah. Yep.
I mean, is that the expectation?
Nice. I think what I would say about it, just in a broad brushstroke, is that. Teaching at tier one, which is our general instructional teaching for youngsters, is it's getting much, much more explicit. So some of the homework the teachers are talking about, there's actually a little sheet that Amy Toff gives them. And let's say that Lindy and Janie and Amy were in my reading group. There's a planning sheet. So I'm looking at the books that they're reading for tomorrow, and I'm looking at this planning sheet, and I'm saying, okay, I have to be sure to teach this, 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 and this. I have to be sure children are responding to this, this, and that.
Okay.
So it's much more explicit than what I found reading instruction to be when I first came to Rochester.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Great.
And that's no criticism of Rochester.
That's what reading instruction has been
in the state of Vermont.
But September, October, November, barely 2 months, 2.5 months in. Mm-hmm. So I don't expect, you know, obviously this is getting used to this. What's the feedback from the teachers?
That's what she was saying. Good timing.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, two pages of what the faculty are saying.
He's probably
not without these, I'm not reading anything. Yeah.
You know, they really are appreciating the collaborative nature.
Excellent.
Working together. A lot of the teachers have never had that before. They're the only teacher in their school in that grade, and they don't get to talk to anyone else. And now they're going outside of their classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
It's uncomfortable for some of them, but they are doing it, and they're ready to take that challenge on, to invite people in their classroom. And some of that is through video, that if they videotape it and show it to other people, that's inviting people into their classroom.
Mm-hmm.
So they are more reflective. That's one of the things they say.
And just, is this data just from our two schools?
No, this is across the whole supervisory unit. Everybody is working together.
And you, Lindy, and Bonnie would echo what she's saying here. Some people are tough, but they're doing it.
Exactly, I don't think, I know. We don't have a single teacher who isn't buying into it. Now, some are buying into it at a higher level than others right now. Others are being a little more cautious. Mm-hmm. But everyone understands that there's a trite saying in educational research, or in education, that if we keep doing what we've always done, we'll keep getting what we always got.
Gotcha.
And our assessment results are just not okay. So we can't keep doing what we've always gotten, because we have way too many kids that aren't meeting standard and aren't becoming strong readers.
Okay.
And I would say it's tough for teachers because it's new and because they want to be so good at it right now. And it really is making them think about their instruction in a different way, in a positive way. So that's why...
Is there information going home to parents about this new initiative and the way it works?
We sent an initial, so let me answer by saying no, not enough.
Okay.
And that's something that we should be giving more attention to. We did send home an initial, I forget what it was either in a newsletter or a little thing that we were starting a reading initiative. There was some exciting new materials, but we by no means went into it.
This is good. This is good publicity.
Yeah, one of the things I think we
This is good publicity for
right.
Him.
One of the things I think we should do when we get a little further into it is we actually should do, I think, a community presentation where we invite families in to hear about
it's a great idea.
Both, you know, our literacy framework, our pilot that we're going to be talking to you about in a minute. Because the whole goal is, it really doesn't matter who teaches a child to read. We just have to hold hands and make sure that every single one of our kids becomes strong readers. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, from the collaboration that Lindy talked about that teachers are valuing at this point in time. They see all of us in this together.
And part of this professional development, and this is part of what Amy Toth has created, is a website. And that website has talking points for teachers to include in their weekly newsletter. So if they're following that, they can add that and
are all our teachers putting out weekly newsletters? Because I know
they're not putting out weekly newsletters, they're putting out newsletters. And Amy also gives us these, I forget what we call them, but they're these monthly posters.
What to celebrate, what to focus on.
And we post them in the schools, and we post them where they're highly visible for folks.
Or the banner.
But another good point, Ethan, we probably should do more about getting that out to parents. I think at this point, it's going to sound like an excuse I don't intend it to. We've been so focused on getting things implemented.
Absolutely. I really, it's an encouragement.
I don't hear it as criticism.
We here did an open house as part of our PBIS initiative, and we asked the kids to show their parents what the routine was around literacy or and math, like every part of their day.
Nice.
As we were working about expectations. And that was just something that was a goal that came from our climate survey, some feedback here at Stockbridge. And then in terms of, we're really just trying to get and encourage parents to just help log reading at home. When are you reading at home? Mm-hmm. What are you reading at home? Talking with their kids at home. Nothing formally where you would be like, hey, this is from our Raising Readers initiative. Because we want parents to start the conversation with their kids. We don't want to push them.
I feel like in the last couple of weeks with the November I Love to Read month, that I don't know about Rochester, but I know that Stockbridge, you know, you sent out, send a picture of your kid reading, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
And like ask them about what their goal is and stuff like that.
Right.
That's all part of it.
Yeah. One of the things that we observed is sort of a soft indicator. It wouldn't stand up to rigorous, you know, critiquing of research, but we had a tremendous turnout for our book fair. Mm-hmm. I think it was more youngsters being more excited about reading, bringing more parents to school to go through the book fair. And I think this reading initiative accounts for a pretty significant part of that.
That is one of the things we're hearing, is that students are more engaged in the reading process. And I notice as I go around from school to school, I mean, they're reading to each other, and they're like, I want to read, and they're raising their hand, and I mean, it's just
great.
It's really exciting.
May I just put my little two cents in about libraries again? The power of libraries, that they are the ongoing book fairs of our schools.
Well, and I think this really supports the classroom library, which is key.
Good.
And I actually was informed by a third grader yesterday that he didn't want to read this book for the third time. He wanted to see what the new book
That's great.
So I think there's a lot going on in people's classroom libraries as well.
Great.
Yeah, exactly. There's a new book and you're holding out on me.
Yeah.
And I was like, am I looking at the same child? Uh-huh. You know, so.
And we did.
That's great.
We did collaborate with the school librarians as well. Mm-hmm. So they are all on board and they're providing lists for families to go in and say, your student likes reading this type of book, here's a list of books that
they
might like. So it is incorporating the libraries too. Mm-hmm. It's a very important component.
Excellent. Good.
Did I leave anything out, Rich?
No.
I think that's all.
Could we ask, I personally would love to have this be, you know, every 3 months. You know, come back in January or something like that and give us an update.
January, we will have our next testing window.
Yeah, so maybe February.
Results to show.
That's a great idea.
Yeah, February.
Okay, that'd be great. That'd be great. Because I just, it's, I mean, personally, this is the work I want to be doing as a school board member.
Isn't it exciting?
Is to be here about the kind of actual stuff that's going on in the school. I know others might say it's all about budgets, but you know, budget supports kids. Kids is what it's about. So great, thank you.
Thank you.
For the board.
So one of the other components that we're doing that you might have seen in Bruce's odds and ends emails is a pilot program with Jeannie's assistance as well, around direct instruction. Mm-hmm. And so everything that Amy Toth is doing with our literacy framework right now is really engulfing, and she has complete buy-in from our tier one or our general classroom teachers. And I can't stress that enough, because our teachers especially, they just love being able to work with her and having that support on site. But there are still a handful of kids that you kind of scratch your head and wonder what's not connecting for them, for whatever reason. And
this be called our tier two and tier three?
Jeannie kind of came to us and said she would be willing to help pilot a direct instruction program for 8 different students, 4 from Stockbridge and 4 from Rochester, that fall within the tier two, tier three category, that are struggling and have made little to no growth, and we just can't quite figure out why, and help train different instructors that work with those students in another tool in their toolbox.
Including chapter two teachers? Is that,
so, or
is
what tier it, two. Right? So,
title two.
Yeah. Tier two are title teachers, or what they, they're supportive of title one funds.
Or
interventionists.
Thank you.
And this is typically students that are below grade level. They're supported in and out of the classroom through these interventionists. And we've selected 6 students from this group who have been struggling and making little progress. And then in tier three, those are our special education students. And we selected 2 students from this group that, despite lots and lots of effort, they haven't made any progress. And we mean effort from kids and adults in the instruction provided there.
So just to pick up from there, as Lindy said, we carefully selected 8 youngsters. 6 are regular ed youngsters. 2 youngsters are special ed eligible youngsters. And they're really youngsters, again, as Lindy said, that we're seeing a lot of effort from. We know they've had pretty decent instruction, but we're sort of scratching our heads because they're just not making the progress that they want to make. And we would expect they should be making, given all the components that are going into it. So Jamie is going to work with, and Deb Matthews also opened this training up to special educators throughout the district. And I think as of this afternoon, there were 3 other people who have asked to join the training. So there would be those 3 special educators, the special educator who works in both Stockbridge and Rochester, and then the interventionist from Stockbridge and the 2 people that do intervention work at Rochester.
Okay.
So there's going to be a good-sized group. And we're looking at this as an opportunity to figure out, is there some way that we could help these youngsters become stronger readers? We're going to be presenting some student achievement data in a minute, and I know people tend to look at scores and this and that, but I would always encourage us to remember that every single score represents a child or children.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, we want the scores to go up simply because we want kids to be stronger readers. And if youngsters are stronger readers, then the scores will go up. Jamie is going to do 3 full days of training, and there's significant
buy-in. I'm getting up early. I'm getting up early.
You didn't want to do that for me.
No, I did. I don't want to do it for anybody.
She wanted to schedule it from 1 in the afternoon till 9 at night. So she had to do 9 in the morning till 3
in the afternoon. With the cocktail break, it's 5.
And we're looking at this as another tool in teachers' toolboxes. Absolutely. In fact, one of the interventionists from Rochester that's going to join doesn't have any children in the pilot. She doesn't have any children that were selected, but she wants to learn the skills. She wants to learn the approach.
We love a teacher like that. Yeah.
She's trying to learn as much as she can about our new F&P materials. She sees that as a huge tool, and she wants to add this to her toolbox. So we're excited. We're hoping, crossing my fingers, that we can get the actual instruction started very early in December. We have to get permission from parents for Janie to do the initial assessment that lets us know at what level of these materials will a child start.
Is there money?
There's no money.
No.
You say pilot.
Pilot.
How so? What's it mean? What's the goal?
Pilot would be we picked a small group of youngsters so that we can implement this program with Janie's training. There's also coaching, like there is in Amy's training, to see how much of an effect it will have on youngsters, and then we'll have to sit down and based on what we're seeing,
figure
the results
out where
say,
we get money.
Okay. One of the things I've mentioned to Deb Matthews, so I don't feel like I'm telling tales out of school, and I've mentioned it to Bruce before, is that we don't quite have the alignment in our tier three materials we wished we had.
This was Janie's, I remember very clearly your criticism of the F&P was that great, tier one, tier two, tier three was sort of okay. But the fact is the real criticism was, so I am a little concerned to hear that you're bringing in someone outside of F&P, is that right?
Yep, Fontesimpinal.
To take care of these, obviously, these are tier two, three, right? These are tier three readers?
Tier two and tier three.
Tier two and
tier three. Two and tier three.
So why are you concerned?
Well, because this was your criticism of the F&P.
Yeah, but...
So are you using F&P?
No.
So remember, F&P is just books, right?
F&P is just materials.
The literacy framework that we started was to focus on our general ed population, mm-hmm. to reach every single student that walks in the building.
Okay.
If we can strengthen that, we'll have less numbers in tier two and tier three.
Okay.
And that's the premise behind what we're doing. Now, this is where Janie and I...
That has never been explained to me in quite those terms ever before.
And so the way Janie... This is...
The people that we're going to be training will have another tool in their back pocket to try to get at kids that are having a hard time.
Okay. No, I get
so
that.
So they'll be using the program that
I'm just echoing your...
That's what they're going to be trained in. It's not going to be the books from F&P. They're going to be trained in direct instruction. They're going to be using
the
program that I have been talking about.
Okay.
So they'll all...
Is this just a pilot program, or is this...
Just a pilot program.
Just a pilot.
Is Amy Toth doing direct instruction?
No. It's my implementation.
It's different what you're doing than what she's doing.
It's a different approach.
She's doing coaching. You're doing direct instruction.
With tier one. And Janie is focusing on tier two and three.
And I will be doing coaching too. It's probably just more...
Because that's the best practice.
Interventionist.
Because I remember your description very much of the teacher, the coach being in the classroom, watching the teaching happening in the moment, having saying the jumping up, okay.
And that's...
That's what we wanted. That's what we want. Okay.
And that's what's happening.
Good. Thank you.
I think it's safe to say what has gone on in tier three, and correct me if you have another way of looking at this, in most schools for a long time has been more of the same. There's some slight switch in approach, but in general it tends to be more of the same. What we're figuring out is that doesn't work for kiddos. There's a fundamental way in which they learn differently. Mm-hmm. And what we're hoping is between the literacy framework and the F&P materials and the methodology that Amy is working with teachers to develop for tier one youngsters, Janie's work with the teachers who basically work with youngsters who are struggling from a little bit to a great deal, will have a positive impact on them. So we will have two very different ways of approaching reading instruction in our supervisory union. Now, I need to be clear, Stockbridge and Rochester, that's why we're calling it a pilot for a bit, only youngsters from our two schools are in this pilot. Teachers from other areas, other schools want to participate in the training, but they're not using it with youngsters yet.
Yeah.
So that's sort of why we're calling it a pilot.
Okay.
Right.
Good.
That makes sense.
You want me to say something?
And then Janie's going to talk about the major components of direct instruction.
Is that what she's going to? She made me, she said I had to stay on script. You know how difficult that is.
Did she give you a script?
Well, no. She wrote down a little thing in an email.
She has it in the office.
It's Lindy's in my evil eye. It's the script.
Okay, got it.
I first have to say, okay, that I have been relentless, I think, in my concern about this program. And I know what?
Relentless is a good term.
And I know how I can be. So.
Well, you're putting your money where your mouth is. I love
it. But I more than appreciate the fact, first of all, these two principals, guys, we are so fortunate. Oh my goodness, we are so fortunate. Because the only thing they care about is making sure that the kids learn and student achievement. And however that happens, they're going to fight for it. And I mean, they're going to fight for it, okay? The second thing is Bruce. And again, and you're not second, I don't mean second. But it's.
Well, we think you should
be second. I don't care if I don't even show up on the list.
As long as I don't say anything, right?
I don't need anything.
Seriously, again, relentless and critical.
Yeah. Well,
and
I understand. I've heard you.
We had lunch, he sat down. I was not surprised at his decision tonight, not at all. Because he is for the kids. And so putting everything aside, Janie, okay, do it.
Good for you.
So we're gonna do it as a pilot just in Rochester and Stockbridge. Teachers will be coached weekly. They'll get, as we said, 3 days of training. Each student is assessed individually and placed into the appropriate level of program. And then they will get an explicit approach to direct to reading, which is a very structured, scripted presentation that has a lot of embedded testing in it, so that we will know every 5 lessons where these kids are and where they're going. And it's engaging besides anything else. I have worked with several children from Stockbridge and a child from Rochester, and the growth, direct instruction is designed to accelerate learning. Mm-hmm. For the kids who are behind, we can't make 10 months of growth for 10 months of instruction. We have to make more than that, and that's what direct instruction does.
Oh.
Its total premise is all learning is a function of instruction. So we have to monitor the instruction. And it accelerates the learning. The professional development is extremely intense that the teachers will be going through. They role play, they get up in front of me and they have to do a lesson, they have to present a lesson by the end of the training. They have to correct. I'll make mistakes and they have to correct me. And it's an intense training. But I think, again, the support that we have from this instructional leadership and from the SU, and regardless, guys, of how I feel about the Tier 1 program, their focus is literacy.
Yeah.
That's gotta raise the scores. Mm-hmm. Just that alone raises the scores, that the focus is there. So I am very grateful that this is going to be going on. And we will keep you abreast of all the results.
Good.
Wonderful, thank you.
You
were great.
Sure. Just remembering that the your vision is 90 minutes of reading a day, 60 minutes of math. 75 minutes of math a day.
Some people would say 90, but 75 is
75. So
that's because she's an expert.
We are hearing a lot about, but I have another question, and that is, my son's a very high-level reader. How's he being taken care of in all this literacy, where he already has, excessive skills?
He's in a reading group based on
His ability.
Just like Janie mentioned, it should be said that, just like Janie mentioned how frequently these students in the direct instruction program are assessed, classroom teachers are doing running records, which which makes sure that kids are constantly in that right instructional level.
Good.
So they
Good.
Are, so your child's getting challenged just as, you know,
Good. Thank you.
Johnny's child is being challenged and learning to move at the same time.
And once a youngster gets fluid at that decoding, then they move into to application and interpretation. Mm-hmm. And that's where a lot of our upper level readers will find themselves every day, interpreting, applying, retelling.
Yep.
So using reading to learn.
Did you read his book? Did you see his book?
I didn't see his book.
Oh yeah, it went around the, his classroom.
I'll have to look at it.
We published a book that he wrote. Anyway, good.
The other thing I was gonna say that I think is important, both Janie and Amy were very insistent on this, that administrators take part in this training. So the one thing that was not negotiable with Janie was that Lindy and I were gonna be there on those 3 days. So I think that's crucial, just like it is in Amy's model, because it's, we not only set the tone of the building, but we have to be able to go around and help people figure out, what should I do now? Am I getting this right? Do I change it? How do I change it? So we're learning right along with the teachers.
Okay. And not only that, I mean, they really, again, you know, I didn't want after school training. It just doesn't work out as well if you do it, and it's after a whole day. 3 days of training, that's it, we'll do it. Three full days, so.
That's great.
Really, it's really supportive, very supportive.
Just don't send us any emails for those 3 days.
Yeah.
We're not gonna be answering.
Yeah.
Just warn us,
kids.
Yeah. This is your warning.
Excellent.
So any other questions for any of us? Mary Ellen, Janie, Lindy, myself?
Yep, answered all mine.
I think I just wanted to echo that this is, you know, it is nice to be able to take out a block of time to look at it, to think about this.
It's wonderful.
And to, you know, focus on the education piece and not on the budgets and the labor negotiations and those things. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Great. See, we got a lot.
Are you staying in
everything.
The same place to talk about student assessment? Or is that somebody else?
That's us.
Oh.
What we're going to suggest is we pass this out. We will talk about it briefly, but given the time, we want to do justice to this as well as other things on our agenda. So we might suggest that a more thorough discussion of this go on next month's agenda, but we want to get a start tonight.
Okay.
So what Lindy's handing out, we chose two pieces of data to share with you. If you look at the side that says SBAC Spring 2019, on the top, it'll say
it's front and back.
Don't rush too fast.
No, I won't. It'll say SBAC.
Moving slowly.
Spring 2019. SBAC is the Smarter Balance Assessment Consortium.
That's the person who did the test?
No, that's an acronym.
What is it?
It's a computer-given.
Smarter Balance Assessment Consortium. And the state school officers, I think there's like 48 states.
Smarter Balance Student
Assessment.
Assessment.
Consortium.
As I say, I hear things slowly.
It's okay. And the
great word.
State school officers, which are the commissioners of education, I think it's 46 or 48 states, supported the work around the SBAC development. And the SBAC has been around, Carl, what, maybe 8 years, 10 years?
Not that many.
Okay, maybe.
Maybe five, half dozen, maybe. I think it's under 10.
All right, it's probably under 10, but
let's
it's.
Let's go with eight. You said eight
works. Eight works. So what it is a computer-administered, youngsters take the test via a computer program. There is a literacy section, there is a mathematics section. And what we will just share this evening, and then I'm gonna suggest we put it on the December agenda for questions. We in both schools, I'm sorry, let me say one other thing. On the back, if you flip to the back, you'll see we've put results for the STAR 360 assessment, and that is a assessment that's administered district-wide 3 times a year. And what you're seeing here is what we refer to as the baseline. So this is the fall STAR 360 assessment that was given, I think it closed out October 1st. So between the first day of school and October 1st, youngsters were given the STAR assessment in reading and mathematics. The SBAC is given in the spring. So what you're looking at
is the last
is last year's spring SBAC. So our current sixth graders show up in here as fifth graders.
So it's only, SBAC is only given once a year.
And on the SBAC side, on the front side, the sixth graders that are listed there have aged off in middle school.
They're now seventh graders.
Okay.
And SBAC is given once a year.
Yep.
And it's required in the state of Vermont. So all schools take it.
Just a little like language translation. So it says percent at 3 or above.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so 3 means the student is proficient.
Thank
it
you.
Could be a wide range
oh, yeah.
of where
it's in
they
like
fall.
The grade, like in the grade cards.
Right.
Yeah.
And
so
just
3 or 4.
So you know, and then again, a little sloppy copy and paste on my part on the back where it says percent at 3 or above. I copied and used the same chart. The info in it is accurate, but I didn't change the heading.
You're on the star 360 side?
On the star 360
yeah,
side.
Just take that right
same
out.
Same thing. Those are the kids that are proficient. Considered proficient and on grade level.
So 60% at star 360.
So basically
out of 8 students
top.
Tested, 50% of them are at 3 are at proficient.
So when you're saying level 3, it's a proficiency based
right.
grading. And you're saying that this is, you know, from the beginning, approaching, meeting, exceeding. These are the kids that are at the very, very minimum of meeting. They're just squished into the meeting bucket all the way up to the highest flyers at
correct.
The top of the
sheet. Exactly. Correct.
So this is you know the 27% of last year's fourth graders in Rochester were
proficient or exceeding.
We're barely meeting to all the way fully exceeding.
Right. And the reason we chose to show it this way is we have to be very careful because we have very small numbers.
Right.
Yeah.
Even our largest class is a very small number. So
right.
we have one
he's
class that if it, that if one student goes up by enough to just make it into the proficiency level or goes down by enough to make it into below proficiency, that will change
talking
the
80 to
by
60
30,
or
33%.
33, okay, yeah.
So our small numbers, we need to be cautious of.
So,
but we just let me say this one thing, Ethan, then I'll take your answer. Question.
Question.
Lindy and I by no means want to try and talk away any of these numbers.
Mm-hmm.
They are not where we want them to be, pure and simple. We need to work harder at having our youngsters become stronger readers, stronger mathematicians, stronger writers. And that's sort of the broad brushstroke of these two assessments. So we consider this baseline. We're working from here, trying to go up in the strength of our kids. And that's the other comment I wanted to make is the only reason you'll hear us focus on raising the scores is an indicator that our youngsters are becoming stronger readers, stronger mathematicians, stronger writers, which is really the goal.
Yeah, well, and to improve our offering. You know, kids are becoming, it's being a better school, not recruiting better kids.
Exactly.
You know, so it's you know, it's important to look these in the eye and not try to explain them away or not try to
right.
you know to be as transparent as we can without violating FERPA. You know, because it's important that we know and that we can address them, because what is going to, you know, what makes a family in Pittsfield choose to send their kid to Killington or to here? Sure, in some ways it's which way the parent goes, that's always what we say, but if there's a school that a kid, a parent feels fits their kid better, I think they might drive a few minutes this way or bring their kid to a Stockbridge bus stop instead. So I mean, I think that, and then that's going to be based on yeah, how we market ourselves, but also on the quality of what we're doing and that we're showing that we're producing kids that are successful in middle school and high school.
So can you say again, on the star 360 side,
yep,
you accidentally cut and paste just that percent at 3 or above,
just
and what is it supposed to be instead? It's supposed to be at grade
so
level?
They use grade level.
Grade level. So on the reading side, grade 3,
yep.
50% are at or above grade
correct.
Level.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
For this time in the year. That's
for this one back. Snapshot of...
Correct.
Right, star 360,
okay.
That obviously the standards should change. As the school year goes on, right?
Okay.
Am I saying that correctly? I just want to make sure.
So Lindy's example would be a good example of my caution around small numbers. It would be great if this happened, but we need to be reminded it's small numbers. So basically that means three of those six youngsters are at or above grade level.
If the other three are just slightly below,
it does hold
and we nudge them in to at or above grade level, it's going to look, it's going to say 100% of the youngsters are at or above grade level, and isn't that wonderful? It is wonderful, but it's three youngsters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that's going to be our caution around small
numbers. This a is this a selection of the class as a whole? Or this is
no,
all
this
the kids?
No, this is everybody. These are this all the kids.
So there were six kids in the third grade class in Rochester.
At the beginning of the year.
Wow. Well, the six kids that were tested, little Susie might have been sick.
I think we only have one place where that was Eastman. I think we only, Carl, I think we only have one youngster that did not complete the test.
The good thing about Stockbridge is it's quite a range. It's a long time. The window is about a month long. So we monitor that because we are so
right. And certainly that affects much more.
And you're
more
looking for instructional.
On the SBAC side, you know, the fact that that's you're giving out the day, maybe you have a makeup day, maybe you don't.
Right.
That's
a different. Yeah.
I certainly think this would be a good thing to talk about more deeply at the December meeting.
Mm-hmm.
I think, at least speaking for me and everyone else on the board could chime in, what I'd like to hear is, you know, from you guys is the strategies we're taking to try to, you know, improve the deficits this show and less of the, you know, methodology or the testing breakdown, but what we're doing to, you know, how we're trying to use this information to make things better.
And actually, Carl, I probably should have said January versus December. Marielle, correct me, because January, the second 360 window will have closed, right? So we'll have
January 31st, it will close. Oh, so we'll need February
because we won't have any new STAR 360 data until the end of January 31st.
So again, that's February. So there's your February meeting again, which is the same time that Mary Ellen is going to come
budget,
right, and get.
Well, I mean, the good thing is if the testing window closes on the 31st of January, by our February meeting, whatever that first Tuesday is, the window will close, the data will be there.
The data will be there.
And, you know, hopefully, I don't know which day it is, how many days you'll have to crunch those numbers before we see you in February wanting to know between the base, you know, the September baseline and the February, you know, what growth are we showing appropriate growth in the course of this school year.
Yeah. At a minimum, we'll have trends. It'll say it's going up in these three grades, we're holding level in this grade, we're wondering what's
great
going on in this grade.
Yeah.
So at a minimum, we'll have that.
Great.
We will also probably, December, January, February, by February, we probably will have been in the pilot long enough to at least make some preliminary statements about how it's going.
Oh, definitely.
Okay. So maybe February is a better time.
Yeah, and it's basically, it'll be again an education meeting. It'll be, you know, because.
Right, well, we have to talk about that because we also have that February retreat.
Oh, yeah.
It'll be an education meeting. And depending on where we are in the budget process, we may not be able to afford taking February off.
No. Budget season, we're going to meet more.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Two questions?
Yes.
The first is, if this, because of the small data pool or some term like that, is this useful for small schools?
I think it's very useful.
Okay.
We,
so even though it can get skewed very easily by a single student.
I think that's part of what you're seeing here is that we haven't, in the past, used data effectively to inform our instruction.
Okay.
And we're guilty. We're all guilty of that in a different way. And it's not to say we don't have fabulous teachers in our building.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that we're not using this to make the right gains for our kids.
Okay.
And
these cool.
Are trending data is important too. Where the kids are headed is important. Yeah, you have a small sample size, but we haven't been looking at any data before this, so
yeah.
You know, we've been blind to all that.
Okay.
So it's important that we start to look.
Good.
One of the things we're doing to make it statistically significant is putting all the schools together.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're looking at the supervisory union level. How are we doing as a supervisory union? Where are the numbers going?
Okay.
And that is statistically significant.
Good.
And then the other thing that our small size allows us to do, even though we have to be careful, those three youngsters, let's go back to where were we? We were on STAR 360, grade 3, Rochester.
those three youngsters that weren't meeting the standard, we can go right in and find them. Mm-hmm. We can go right in and find their running record. We can find what level text they're on. We can find all sorts of things about them.
You're going to have a lot more, a lot more information.
Much easier than you can.
Yeah.
You just can't make gross generalizations about it.
Yeah. Good. Second issue, and this sort of goes back to the literacy assessment. What are we doing to unify writing, mathematics? You know, we're obviously doing a lot of work to unify literacy, but what about these other issues? I mean, writing's a big one for me, because I think it's really important myself, almost as important as reading.
I'd like to know about our STEM progress, too. I think those areas
Exactly.
Educational report, we covered literacy and assessments. Let's move into those next areas and get a deep dive into our math, STEM, integration, writing.
So here's what I would say about that.
And we can talk about this more later. It's a question out there.
Just in terms of a broad brushstroke, I guess I would put it this way, is that we began with the subject area, breaks my heart to say this, with the subject
area. I know, I hear you.
We felt leveraged most success for youngsters, which is
across the board.
Across the board.
I hear you.
And we started there. And under Mary Ellen and Bruce's leadership, just said, here's what we're doing, and we're moving forward in literacy, and I agreed with that.
I've taken my lesson from Janie that, that's great. Right. I'm very glad you're doing that.
Exactly.
How about the next thing?
So the next step has to be.
And you say, not yet.
Nope.
The research bears that out. You can't give the teachers
too much. Yeah,
that they're
going
to start to feel overwhelmed and then mm-hmm. the motivation goes away. So.
No, I get it.
Yes. And the focus has to be reading right now. It has to be.
But at the same time, I think to echo, I think that, I don't expect there's going to be as full-fleshed out and some sort of STEM support program, but understanding how we're making sure that we're not losing sight of that ball as well. I think it's okay for them to not have as a deep dive into writing prompts and mechanics like that, but I think it's important that we keep building.
Oh, absolutely, and writing.
Well, with these teachers are all together, 5 minutes to talk about, your other stuff too.
We can leave it.
We're doing good. We're way ahead.
Put
a half hour.
We need to maximize it. I love you all dearly. This time change is great. But it's happening. For example, tomorrow during our half day, there's teachers that aren't teaching literacy. We have specific math objectives for them to be working on.
Okay.
Have some concerns in that area, and we're not letting it go. But what I am going to say is, and we've slowly been having this conversation, as I think there's something to be said that's got to go into the school day. We're trying to jam pack a lot of things into the day that can't adequately be done.
Yep.
I think a couple needs that we have. First of all, and as Lindy said, we are going to move forward with these other things. And the thing I love about the reading programs we're moving forward with, both Amy's and Jenny's, is that it gives us a model for how we can move forward with the next subject area. The other thing that we've talked to Bruce about has to come out through negotiations, because one of the things that struck me coming to this district is it has far fewer in-service days than any district I've ever worked in.
And we gave up Windsor Northwest in service days, part of the SU merger.
Yeah, and that's a negotiation topic. We can't change that except through negotiations.
Absolutely.
The other thing we also have
I'm
to change.
I'm just making sure you do the district.
Right. The other thing we also want to start the board in a conversation, want Bruce and Mary Ellen to be part of it, is that with the expectations that everyone has now, we don't have a long enough school day. Now, I don't want kids in school 10 hours a day, but we're pretty short. I know a number of schools that have a full 7.5 or 8 hour instructional day. That means morning meeting and breakfast and all that happens outside of that 7.5 or 8 hours. And it's not, what they call drill and kill. Kids aren't sitting in their seats and just, but it's time to make transitions. It's time to work on STEM things. It's time to get the
75 minutes we need for math and the 90 minutes we need for literacy?
That's not a negotiation time.
But the length of the school day is, isn't it?
Stratford, no, it says up to 8 hours. So you guys can go up to 8 hours.
But that's when teachers have to
Does Stratford
right?
go longer? Stratford has
they
a longer day?
They
do.
But they have it every Friday.
Newton Elementary.
That, the students do or the teachers do? Okay. Well, the students are there for 8 hours.
Well, let's not start yep. diving into
no,
the
let's not, yeah, right.
I think that's just
a comment.
But thank you, yeah.
Why literacy? Why not math? Why not?
No. It's not. That isn't my point.
Well, you're missing the point somewhere. We're really.
No.
We said we're okay with
her. No,
talk about the next conversation.
I get it.
Oh, my God, they're agreeing with you.
No,
I just want to make the point. I want our teachers to feel some success.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that will be contagious mm-hmm. for the other initiatives that we're going to have. Once they get the ball rolling and they realize that if they work together, they can make some things happen. That's collective efficacy that we were talking about. It will be infectious, mm-hmm. and they will start to attack other areas. And we also know that math will improve when literacy improves. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a known fact.
This
is good.
The research says that once the culture of the teachers is collaborative, you see kids being more collaborative because that's the atmosphere of the school.
Okay.
So it transfers into a lot of things.
And I think once again, without deep diving into the past of either of our schools, we have great teachers. They were just looking for some sustained leadership. They were looking for the mergers to be over. They were looking for someone to come
Stability.
Into the buildings and
yeah.
say, you're doing great work. We just have to align some of this stuff, and we have to start using data to make our decisions. And there's a significant amount of enthusiasm going on now in our two schools that I honestly did not see when I first came here.
Oh, I can totally understand that.
Okay.
Good.
All right, thank you.
Great, thank you.
I suggest that we table any policy review. Let's all review the policies that are here.
Thank you, Mary Ellen.
We'll discuss them at our next meeting.
Please read them. I don't want to lose.
I do have a question. I do have just a question for clarity about the first two policies say that they are for Sharon district only. Is that correct? This is
so
not a policy that we're reviewing?
What happened is you adopted a policy. Sharon didn't like the policy.
Okay.
They adopted their own policy. I went back to the policy committee and said, we have to figure this out so that we don't have two different policies.
Okay.
And the policy committee said, we like what Sharon did.
Okay, so you'd like us to reread
that.
It and...
So
and
we have
you
a
want
copy
to adopt
of
Sharon
ours.
On those two.
Okay,
we,
thank you.
Can you please have the full policy packet sent to everybody, Bruce? Because they want to see what the original policies were.
I just need to see Sharon's next to ours.
Well, the ones that are right. Was there bolded wording? The only difference was the principal was put in there.
No, we added the principal. Sharon added more about like room renting.
I'll send you the
order. That would be great. Because
there will be more coming.
There
will be more coming. So
okay.
In the principal's report, Bonnie, you had the piece you wanted to talk to us about the roof.
Yes. Just to think about this, and we can resolve it at the November-December meeting. Every time we get any amount of rain, we've gotten significant leaks in the elementary school roof. The people who repair it tell us the roof is shot. That's their words. So I want to chat with the board about how we move forward in discussions about replacing that roof. I have some pretty significant concerns about how we're going to limp along through the winter, but we're going to do the best we can do it. We really need to address the replacement of that roof.
Okay.
We
were already going to talk about authorizing you guys to go out and get information on testing the air quality inside the two key recommendations the building committee came up with in our last meeting going through the report that was supported by not just the board, but the board members there, but some of the, with Cricket and Willis Whitaker, the two commercial engineer types that are on the committee. We're saying that we really need to move forward on figuring out what the air quality is in this building and getting the air quality tested in all three, I'm sorry, not in this building, in all three buildings, getting the air quality tested so that, and with a recommendation for what fixing that would cost, so we know how healthy the air is in these buildings, because some of the some of the urgent needs of the building that were expressed were about air circulators. Next, there's the report really highlighted the fact that we have no idea how old or what condition those tanks are, and going out and finding someone that can give us a strong evaluation that can address issues like, do we want to move to a propane solution and try to encapsulate the tanks for now or whatever, but getting that information so we can make a good decision for our budget. And then thirdly, the roof. I think we really need to, if you say the roof has to be addressed, we need to get someone in to tell us what our options are, what's it going to cost to repair it. If we repair it for that cost, how long will it last? What's a replacement cost? And then we can have those decisions and make decisions about them in December, whether we have to do something right away, whether we have to things that we obviously have to put in the next budget, however we're going to do that. But to get that information, we need to authorize you guys to go out and get the people in and get the proposals made for us. So do you think we need to give to authorize you to have any sort of funding you can expend to get some of that testing done? An expense under $2,000.
I was going to say, are we asking for them to get the testing done or asking them to get the, put out like an RFP to get, to, well, or to find out how much it would cost to get the testing done and the roof would be to fix the roof. I mean, because we're not asking them to test the tanks. We want to find out the cost of that and make a decision about.
Right, we have to, the tanks have to be inspected.
So let me share this. I have additional information about the tanks.
Okay.
We're zooming in on some things. Two of them, one at Rochester, one at Stockbridge. They're not permitted. They need to be permitted. Stockbridge's didn't have to be permitted prior to, I forget, 2000 something, because we believe it's a 1,000-gallon tank. The bottom line is, we've spoken to people at the state, Carl, some of those connections that you gave us. Yesterday, I spoke with a woman who gave me two contacts that can help us further explore our tanks. So I'm going to suggest that we make those two contacts and find out what their cost is, find out what they can do for us,
right,
and what they tell us.
Right. What I would like to do as a board now would be to authorize you to be able to, if they come back and say, okay, yeah, to investigate that tank, it's going to be $500 a tank or $1,000 a tank. But us to, while we authorize you to do that, to also authorize you to have some, you know, reasonable sum of money that you don't have to come back to us and say, you know, next month, oh, it's $1,000, and then we say, okay, here's $1,000. But to us to authorize you to expend some sort of base amount of money to do the tank testing, to do the air quality testing, and to if we have to pay someone independent to deal with the roof. But I'd like us to be able to have information. And
are we looking for a an estimate for a fix, or are we looking for an estimate for a stopgap?
So I'd like to ask Jenny a question first, because she might be able to help me. Neither Linda or I have the expertise to write an RFP for a roof replacement. And I know you don't want to use the company who's going to be replacing it to help you write the RFP. So who typically writes RFPs for those kind of projects when you don't have the expertise in your own group?
The SU has been the business manager. Donna, up until we had the string of business managers, Donna Benoit did all the RFP work and all the bid process. So that's where it's traditionally been done.
Of all of that.
Right,
so
right. But I mean.
Who to use and how to, okay.
Right, so Tara should be able to help you, and if the business manager, if she can't do it or something else, push back. But that's generally where the RFPs have come from. Right now, I'm just interested in making sure you have the resources to get that testing done, so we can come back and say, here's what we gotta do to these furnaces, they say. Here's what we gotta do to these tanks.
Last summer, we just,
Stockbridge got their roof replaced
2 years
ago, right?
And Donna was the RFP, I believe.
So Taryn can do the RFP for us?
Well, she can show you what was done, and we can cut paste or whatever in order to be able to make that.
So, but again, the question, are we looking for an estimate for a fix or an estimate to get us through?
What I've been told by two different contractors who have fixed it is that there's really little fix left to it. I mean, they showed me some cracks that you can really almost put your hand into. So I think
we
need a fix.
You can always put rubber and tar over.
I think
things.
We need a fix to get through the winter, which we've done to the extent that we can. It's just new leaks pop up where they don't anticipate them popping up. I think long term for next summer, we need to be, unless someone tells me something drastically different, we need to be writing an RFP to replace the roof.
Right, so we want to get a, start getting quotes now to see what that cost would be.
Yeah, so you put the RFP out, right? And then they respond to the RFP.
I mean, one thing I will say, we had, when I first started the board here, we had a problem, you know, speaking to the idea of having the roofer write the RFP. We had the front half of this roof replaced, and then we're told later that, you know, maybe we could have gotten away with some patches, but, you know, the guy wanted a roof job.
Right.
So,
well, I would guess from the number of leaks we're experiencing, they're probably pretty accurate. They're popping up everywhere in the building.
Sure. I mean, I, as far as my thinking, if there's fixes that have to be done, we have to do it.
Yeah, we've got to do it for the
roof. By putting stuff on the roof versus putting buckets on the halls is
right.
Stuff
right,
on
because
the roof.
At this point, but we can't put a new roof on. It's November, right?
Right. Just to be clear, we've done that. We did a fair amount of work this summer on problem areas that we knew about. It's just that now there are new problem areas cropping up.
The big thing I'm interested in is that we have the information, you know, to be able to put a budget figure in around the roof.
Yep.
If you're pretty sure we need a new roof this summer, we need to be able to say we got a budget this much for it.
We're at time for this, for principals.
I'm good.
Great. So we would I would entertain a motion that we have to decide the dollar amount. Do we have anyone have a feeling?
Well, testing.
I think testing those oil tanks is going to be problematic. I really do. Just because some of the testing is could cause degradation to the tank that's not leaking now. I think we need to find out a little bit more information about it.
Right, but I think we need to if we have to pay the guy to come in and tell us about the testing and the options.
Okay.
You know,
right.
And
what she's saying though is if they do pay for a test, it can cause a leak, which then you're gonna have to dig up the tanks manually.
Sure. A pressure test can do that.
Right. But if we proceed, Carl, with having some funds, because what I found out just yesterday was that there is a second type of test. It's not a pressure test that we could do. It's more costly and there's fewer people who do it, but she did give me a contact for it. I just didn't get a chance to connect with her. So I think if we had some money, I mean, we won't spend it willy-nilly.
Okay.
We know what we need for information. It's just a matter of being able to say to the guy, yes, we'll pay the $150 service call for you to come out and do this test.
Right, or the $500 service call.
Right.
Because
do you have a ballpark number?
Excuse me?
Do you have a ballpark number?
I don't, because I haven't talked to him yet.
Okay, so
the way we've done this in the past is we've said we've authorized them to obtain information on this and released like $3,000 or $2,000.
Up to.
And then they could go and do that, and would, you know, more than that, we have to have a special meeting or whatever. But
does $3,000 sound reasonable?
I think it sounds as good as any place to start. It's not,
up
it's,
to.
If it's not that much, we won't spend it, and if we need more, we'll come back.
Okay.
Do we all? Do you want to make a motion, Carl?
Sure. I make a motion that we authorize the administration to investigate the various issues we've discussed. To investigate the roof / air quality /
oil tanks.
And get the information to determine our best path forward. And we authorize the principals to expend up to $3,000 to obtain that information. Do I hear a second?
Seconded.
Any more discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, so we've got some money to start getting some real answers and getting things out. We have, what is this a corporate resolution to add? Right?
Okay, great. What it is that, I got it. So, as we know, Rochester came into this merger with a couple special funds. These are endowments from people who have passed or not, bequeaths of people's wills. They are in mutual funds, some of them, and they're located at banks. Regardless, for us to, we need to get our treasurer's name on these accounts. That's basically all this is.
Okay.
And I have the paperwork for the two different banks. And so I guess what I'm wanting to do is to make a motion to remove Joanne McDonald and to appoint Rebecca Klein to receive statements and to have access to the account.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? To
to me, it seems like this is
no-brainer.
Our treasurer in charge, so.
Right.
Unless anyone has.
Well, I don't know.
Wow.
Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay.
Nope, I got one more. So I would like to make a motion to remove Kathy Brown and to appoint Rebecca Klein to receive statements and access to the other account.
Ah, okay.
Second.
Thank you.
We're saying mutual funds, I thought you were done. Motion has been made to remove Kathy Brown and add Rebecca Klein to the statements.
Seconded.
And access to the account.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? Or any discussion?
Well, I don't know.
Okay. Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And so then I have stuff for you as chair to sign.
Okay, I will do that.
Thank you, Amy.
You're
welcome. Yeah.
I am going to send out some sort of Survey Monkey to all of you, including the administrator, including the principals, about the February date. I'll cover all the available dates in February. You'll answer that, and then we'll finalize it. We'll finalize it when we have everyone's calendar availability and collate it so we know what our best window is.
Can we try to get that done as soon as possible?
I'm sending the survey, yes. I'm sending the Survey Monkey probably this week.
And do we have even basic gendering items of what we're talking about in February? No. Okay, so it's the idea of it.
We need to get it,
Gotcha.
Right. We should probably look back at our retreat notes from last time.
Right.
Last retreat, we're like, oh, for our next retreat, we should talk about
exactly.
D&D.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Great.
Okay.
I don't know where it falls, but Amy, you mentioned probably you're writing a letter to the Rochester Trustee of Public Funds.
Yes, I was.
Yes.
I think it was due sometime in November.
Yes.
Do we have that out?
I'm going to send that. I will get that copy sent to you, and you can review it, and please individually send me back edits so that it doesn't violate open meeting law.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next meeting, we do have one more executive session for a personnel matter, which we're going to go into in a minute. But our next formal meeting of this board is on Tuesday, December 3rd at Rochester at 6:30. In between then, next Tuesday, the 11th, there is a meeting of the Stockbridge Rochester Special Buildings Committee meeting. That will also be in Rochester, but that will be at 6 p.m. Thank you, everybody. Good night.